The following is a presentation of IMG, America's home for college sports. Live from Quaker Steak and Lube on US 1 in Edison, this is the Chris Ash Show, your chance to talk with the head coach of the Scarlet Knights on the Rutgers IMG Sports Network. Today's show is brought to you by... To be a part of the show, give us a buzz on the Nissan call-in line at 877-384-1869. That's 877-384-1869. Now, let's go live to Quaker Steak and Lube in Edison to talk Rutgers football. Here's Chris Carlin.
Welcome, everyone. It is week six of the Chris Ash Show right here on ScarletKnights.com, RVision, and on 1450 AM WCTC in New Brunswick on this Wednesday, October 5th, as Rutgers gets ready this Saturday to host the Michigan Wolverines, currently ranked fourth in the country, as the Scarlet Knights stripe the birthplace. We'll talk about that in just a little bit. 7 o'clock start this coming Saturday. Thanks so much for joining us. Chris Carlin alongside Eric LeGrand. Big E, how are you?
I'm doing well. I can't believe it's already week six, you just said. That's crazy how fast it's going.
I know. It is nuts. And we've got some stuff to get into with you as well with a new project that you're working on and on national television over this past weekend on Fox NFL Sunday. And, of course, the head coach is Chris Ash. Coach, how we doing?
Doing great.
Good to see you.
You too.
Dan, we had the game the other day, the loss out at Ohio State, and I think you just each and every week get a feel for what the competition level is like in this conference and what makes it so special, an exceptionally high level of football that is played. And I know people point to different conferences around the country. Boy, you look at the Big Ten Conference, and it is right there among the elite. And unfortunately, that's one of those situations where it was proven last week.
The Big Ten has been a strong league for a long time. I think Big Ten football is at an all-time high right now. I think the brand is very strong nationwide. I think there's a high level of recruiting going on in the league. I think there's great coaches, great venues, and it's exciting times in the Big Ten.
And when you talk about the Big Ten, coach, you look at it up and down, you know, there's a lot of teams that are top 25 teams, and you recruit against these guys week in and week out. You know, how is that, you know, when you get to see these guys at, like, the media days and things like that?
Oh, I mean, it's fun. I mean, it's something I've been doing for a while. Obviously been in the Big Ten for a while and know the teams, know the coaches, and know a lot of the players. It's ironic, when we went to the Big Ten media days this year in Chicago, Wisconsin had players there. I was a part of recruiting those players. Ohio State had players there, was there and coached all those players, and we had the players there from Rutgers. So it's kind of neat for me, to be honest with you, to see players from three different programs that I've been associated with.
So, Coach, when you went back and looked at the tape, obviously you weren't pleased with what happened on Saturday, but what were the things that you took out of it that you're looking for this team to build on?
A lot.
Yeah. Yeah,
I mean, just being honest with you,
yeah.
You know, Ohio State was an outstanding football team. I knew that going in. They're talented players. They got a quarterback that should be in the Heisman Trophy conversation. Curtis Samuel, all-purpose back, should also be in that conversation, in my opinion. They're very talented on defense. They're young, but they're very talented. They're fast and physical up front. And, you know, we didn't play very good football. And that's disappointing. It's unfortunate. I thought coming out of the Iowa game, even in a loss, we played well in that game and had a chance to win that game. And disappointed that we took some steps back after last Saturday.
And can you talk about, though, some of the positive things? Because you look at it, I believe there was 6 minutes left in the second quarter. It was only 9-0. You know, you're playing well. Can you talk about actually, like, finishing a half off before it could get just changed at the drop of a dime, just like that?
Yeah, you're right. We were down 9-0 with 6 minutes to go, and you know, I remember looking up at the scoreboard and you know, feeling like we've played decent football. Hadn't played great football. Hadn't put any points on the board. We're struggling to get first downs, but you know, we were doing some things that we needed to get some key stops and at least hold on to the ball long enough to keep the defense off the field. And in the last 6 minutes, the wheels fell off. They went it down, and they, you know, we couldn't get a first down. We punted. They got a touchdown. Again, I thought if we went into 16-0, you know, we still had a chance. And didn't happen. Their kickoff coverage team was able to flip the field position and had us pinned down inside offensively. We couldn't get a first down, so we would punt. They'd get the ball, you know, on their side of the field or on our side of the field, and we just couldn't stop the bleeding at that point. And next thing you know, you look up and, you know, it's 30-something to nothing there, and went into halftime. So went from down 9-0 to 30-something nothing pretty quick.
Want you to be a part of the program? You can give us a call. Our telephone number is 877-384-1869. That's our Nissan call-in line, 877-384-1869. You can also tweet us at Rutgers Radio. That's at Rutgers Radio. And if you're in attendance here at Quaker Steak and Lube and you have a question for Coach Ash, come on over, see our man Jordan in the black Rutgers jacket, and we will get you up and on the air. One thing that that stood out early in the game, and I think continues to stand out, is the play of your corners. It seems like they are a lot more comfortable when they are in press coverage, and maybe than they have been in years past, and they look like their confidence is growing throughout the course of the season. You can really see that.
Yeah, I like those two guys. They've worked extremely hard to perfect the techniques that we want them to be able to play moving forward in our style of defense, and that's press technique. You know, Saturday in the game against Ohio State, we were probably 50-50 press versus off. And a lot of it had to do with just the certain coverages we were in, matched up with the speed that the Ohio State had. But going back and watching the game, we were a lot better in press technique than we were in off technique. It's just what we do more of right now. But I think those two that are playing at a high level, they're confident. And right now with the people on our schedule, I think they can go out and match up with anybody we play.
And Coach, can you talk about some of the teaching techniques when it comes to press coverage or off coverages and some of the differences that their technique has to be in off coverage?
Off coverage I think is very challenging when you're back there, and you, whether you're reading the quarterback or reading the man that you're aligned on, the quick game becomes a struggle to stop. You know, you're backpedaling, they throw the ball, you got to plant, you got to drive, and you got to make a tackle out in space, and all those things have to go well for you to have a good play. I like press technique because you can get your hands on receivers, you can disrupt timing, you can slow down their releases, and when you do have to make a tackle, usually you're in the hip pocket of the receiver, and there's not a lot of space. And, you know, we teach press technique kind of like you teach basketball, just moving your feet, cutting the receiver off, and being able to get your hands on them and disrupt them. And I think our players prefer it right now, too.
You know, when you are teaching the different techniques that you want, as far as corners are concerned, when they're playing off, how difficult is it once the play is in motion to determine exactly how aggressive they want to be in going after a tackle versus letting a guy get behind them quickly, if that makes sense, out in space especially, not being overly aggressive once a ball is caught out in space when they're trying to, you know, maybe a quick screen, something like that?
Oh, you know, every tackling situation is different. We want our players to be aggressive tacklers and take shots when shots are there. But you also need to know what the situation is. Do you have the sideline? Do you have help coming inside out? You know, what the situation is, and all of those are different. And they've got to make those what we call in-flight adjustments and decisions relatively quickly to decide, you know, what type of tackle is it going to be. But those are difficult tackles to make whenever you've got a real athlete out in space and he has space to work with. And, again, that's why we prefer press technique, because there's not as much space for a gifted athlete to work with.
Well, Coach, once you break down the film with your coaches and then you get to go to the meeting with the team and you see the missed opportunities that happen out in the field on the game, and especially when you play on the likes of Ohio State, how much do you harp on that when you talk about that in the meeting and making those big plays and that could just change the game and the whole mindset of a team?
Yeah, missed opportunities can kill a football team. You know, we saw that against Iowa. We had some missed opportunities that cost us in that game. I'll be honest with you, I don't know if there were a lot of opportunities in the Ohio State game. There weren't. You know, there were some plays that I felt like we could have made. I don't know that it would have determined or changed the outcome of the football game. But, we do go through and we point out, hey, here were the plays that were called. Here's the defenses that were called. Here's where we had opportunities to make plays. You know, we missed a sack early in that game against Ohio State that led to a touchdown. We had a couple drop balls that may have changed early on in that game that would have changed field position. You know, we tried a trick play that we didn't execute properly that really took some momentum out of a drive and changed field position. So we talk about that quite a bit.
It may be difficult to analyze or evaluate off of it, but when you looked at Juwan Harris as he kind of slid into more of a prominent role, what did you see?
Oh, I like Juwan's future. We didn't get much going with Juwan Saturday early in the first drive when we did move the ball. He had a nice catch, and I think it was the first or second play of the game. He had a nice catch and had a nice gain. I think Juwan's got tremendous potential. Really excited about having him on our football team. And excited to see him grow and develop as we continue to move forward on the schedule. Again, he's trying to fill some of the roles or positions that we had Janarian doing. So he's got some big shoes to fill.
And now you got Josh Hicks, as you said, filling in some roles for Janarian as a kick returner. How much do you see him playing a more prominent role, I guess, in the offense and in the special teams game?
We put Josh back there to be a kick returner last week, and we're still that position is still up in the air moving into this Saturday. But Joellen Harris is also a guy that's been a kick returner for us, but just didn't feel in that particular game we wanted to put Juwan in a situation to potentially get more hits. He's doing a lot of stuff on offense. He's on other special teams. The one kickoff that we had, Juwan Harris was the guy that ran down and got off the block and made a tackle for a pin him inside the 20-yard line. So you're seeing Juwan all over the field. And if there are some situations or opportunities where I can limit the reps or the number of hits he may take, we're going to do that.
877-384-1869, 877-384-1869. That is our Nissan call-in line. We'll take our first time out of the night. We'll come back. We'll talk a little bit more as Rutgers prepares for Michigan this week. Stay with us. We're just getting started here at Quaker Steak and Lube on Route 1 in Edison for this week's edition of the Chris Ash Show.
Need a place to watch all the pro games? Look no further than Quaker Steak and Lube, Best Wings USA on Route 1 in Edison. 50 TVs, great game day specials starting at just $2, and the best wings in the USA with over 25 different wing sauces. Enjoy our outdoor patio and bar that's open all year round, even in the winter. Give us a call, 732-777-WING. We cater events of any size, dining in or to go. Quaker Steak and Lube, 561 Route 1 in Edison, 732-777-WING.
Hi, Rutgers fans. Chris Carlin here for UPS. Your customers want more from your business, and you've got to make more happen, whether they're in Piscataway or on the other side of the world. Globally or locally, UPS is building solutions to help businesses give their customers exactly what they want. More made easy. UPS, official logistics company of Rutgers Athletics.
The Chris Ash Show returns after this local timeout. This is the Rutgers IMG Sports Network.
Introducing the Rutgers Fan Exchange, powered by Tick City. Can't make it to a game and don't know what to do with your tickets? Looking for the best deals on the biggest games? Buy and sell tickets for all Rutgers home games through the Rutgers Fan Exchange. The only place to find seats from within the trusted Rutgers community. And you control the price. Every order helps support Rutgers athletics. Visit the Rutgers Fan Exchange at RutgersFanExchange.com.
Looking for a place to watch all the Rutgers football action? Enjoy the games with fellow Scarlet Knights fans at these Rutgers athletics official watch party locations. Hoboken's Cadillac Cantina, Tom's Rivers Baker's Water Street Bar and Grill, Freehold's Moore's Tavern and Sports Bar, Monroe Township's Baker's American Bar and Grill, and Quaker Steak and Lube's three locations in Edison, Brick, and Phillipsburg. For more information on the official watch party locations, please visit ScarletKnights.com.
Welcome back to the Chris Ash Show. Got a question for Coach? Dial us up on the Nissan call-in line at 877-384-1869. That's 877-384-1869. Nissan, proud partner of college athletics. Shop ChooseNissan.com. Innovation that excites.
We are live on ScarletKnights.com on RVision and on 1450 WCTC for this week's edition of the Chris Ash Show here at Quaker Steak and Lube on Route 1 in Edison, New Jersey. You can tweet us your questions at Rutgers Radio. We got a couple of those we're going to get to here shortly as Rutgers prepares to take on Michigan this coming Saturday. The fourth-ranked Wolverines will come in off of their win 14-7 the other day over Wisconsin. And, of course, it is a 7 p.m. game for Stripe, the birthplace. And if you're unfamiliar where you've been, first of all, the even sections will wear scarlet to this game, and the odd sections will wear black. All of the student section will wear black. And Coach, I was told just a little while ago the student section is sold out for the game this Saturday night, and that's always a huge, huge boost, I know.
Oh, absolutely. That's outstanding news. We anticipated a great environment Saturday night. Night games here have traditionally been great environments, and I don't expect this one to be any different. And very excited to hear about the student section. We expect the whole stadium to be sold out.
And, Coach, we got to see a little preview of the black jerseys and everything. What did you think of them?
They're pretty sweet, aren't they?
They are. I like the helmet and everything, Coach.
You look good in one.
I'm gonna say I gotta you know, go talk over there, get me, you know, hooked up with one of those jerseys, maybe a helmet too.
I'm sure you know a few people. I'm sure you can work something out.
Yeah, if it's free, get them three.
Exactly. Learned that from our boy Ray Lucas.
Exactly right. Coach, when your team gets back to work, I heard you talk about this a little bit in your news conference this week, that maybe first day or so went a little bit lighter because the bye week comes so much later in the season this year. So how have you kind of handled that with this team, considering they haven't gotten much of a break?
Last Sunday, after the game, typically we go and we evaluate it, we meet, we go out on the practice field, and we get a little correction work, we get special teams work, get a jump start on the next week's opponent. This Sunday we gave them off, not from meetings and evaluating the film, but going out on the practice field and doing any physical activity. It's been a long stretch with training camp, and then the first 5 weeks of the season, and we're banged up. You know, just typical bumps and bruises and some injuries that we've had here in the last couple weeks from physical football games. And I just felt like it was the best thing to do to get their bodies and minds a little extra rest so they can come back and have a good practice on Tuesday. And we did just that.
Yeah, and Chris mentioned earlier, you know, it's week six already. I said how fast it's going. But as coaches and players, I know you got to sit down, you know, take it week by week. How hard is it to just stay focused week by week instead of looking, all right, we got this, do this, got to do this, got to do this. You know, each week you have a plan. But how is it, you know, that you keep everyone in the right mind state to handle it different each week?
Well, the good thing about football is it's a new opponent each week, so you get a chance to change gears each week, win or lose, you're getting on to the next one, and that's what we do. We just worry about the next opponent, and we're worried about just to trying to practice and have the best day that we can have each day that we go out there and focus on the things that we can control, which is our attitude and effort and practice and trying to get better every day. And you know, that's where we're at right now. And you know, we've got three more games here before a bye week, and we've got to get better in these 3 weeks, and we'll use the bye week to kind of rest up and continue to get better. But it's all about us and all about Michigan right now. That's our focus.
Generally speaking, how do you approach practice during the season as far as how physical you want it to get?
Well, Tuesdays, you kind of call it Bloody Tuesdays. It's an mm-hmm. opportunity. It's a physical practice. We go a lot of good on good on Tuesdays. And I really believe that places I've been good on good, you know, ones versus ones is very important during the season to continue to get better. And we do a lot of that on Tuesdays. We'll get some scout team work. And on Wednesdays, the focus turns to primarily scout team work. We'll get a little bit of good on good. But we're going to bang on Tuesdays. Wednesdays, we back off a little bit. And then Thursdays, it's just helmets only. So that's kind of the way we go through the week.
How much have you seen that kind of evolve as the years have gone on? We know how physical it used to be, but the last 5 to 10 years in particular, has it gotten a lot less physical just out of preservation of the kids' health?
You know, there's a sports science that a lot of people use right now to
sure.
try to determine, you know, how the length of practice, how much practice, and the things that they're going to do in practice. And I think that's all great, but, you know, I don't think you can get away from the traditional methods of building a strong, physical, tough football team. And to do that, you have to practice a certain way, and there's got to be some contact. You as a coach, you got to know your team. What do they need? Are they a veteran team? Are they a team you're trying to develop? Have they played a lot of snaps over the last couple years? So, you know, each year is different. Each team is different. And the good coaches know their teams and know what their teams need. But I don't get away. I don't think you can get away from the traditional methods of building toughness out of a football team.
And, Coach, you mentioned the scout teams and their role that they play on Wednesdays and Thursdays. How often do they get to play just Rutgers football and be able to just learn what you guys are developing?
Every Sunday we have a developmental part to our Sunday practices where we're going to go. And this last Sunday we went out, we did individual work with them, 7-on-7 with them, and some move the ball team stuff with them. But every Sunday we're going to do some work with our developmental players. That's part of the season also, is you're obviously trying to develop the players that are playing and get ready for opponent, but you've got to always be looking towards the future and developing those younger players.
Steve on Twitter with his first question tonight, at Rutgers Radio. Once again, you can tweet us your questions at Rutgers Radio. Coach Robert Martin, what has allowed he and the other running backs to really develop into a very deep position on this football team?
One, I think they're good players. The second is the offensive line. There's probably very few running backs that have been great running backs without a very good offensive line and people that buy into blocking for them. And I like our offensive line right now. I like our run game right now. And Rob Martin's a really good back. Goodwin's a good back. You know, Josh Hicks, Trey Snead, those are all good backs. So, you know, they're talented players with a good offensive line, and they all feed off each other.
All right, let's take our first phone call of the night. That is Dylan, who is on campus at Rutgers. He is up first this evening on the Chris Ash Show. Dylan, how you doing?
Great. How are you doing?
Good.
All right. So I don't really have a question here, but I just want to thank Coach Ash and all the staff because these boys are playing hard. And no matter what the score is, they're playing hard for you, Coach. And, you know, that, I think that's the biggest compliment you could ever get. And whatever you're doing, we're still behind you. We believe. And just keep it up. And go RU.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
All right, Dylan. You know, from a coaching standpoint, though, that's got to feel pretty good to hear. Knowing that, you know, not only what you know about your football team, but that people take notice of what the effort level is week in and week out, no matter who you are as a coach.
Yeah, we talk to the team a lot about that. We want to be respected for our mental strength and our physical toughness and the way that we play the game. And when people press play on a remote when they're getting ready to play us, they can look at it and say, you know, this is going to be a four-quarter war. And that's what we want to be able to have in this football team right now today, and that's what we want to build for the future. And you know, when people say you play hard, that's great. We want to be able to play hard, but we also want to win games. And you know, that's part of the process, is to getting the guys to learn how to play hard and compete and stay together for four quarters, regardless of the situation that you're faced with.
And it's funny when we talk about fans, you know, getting them involved and how crazy, you know, fans go to do to pushing things to the limits. I saw something on Twitter today that actually got me to crack up laughing. Somebody said, if Rutgers football beats Michigan this week, I am naming my first son after Coach Chris Ash. What do you think of stuff like that, Coach?
That'd be the stupidest thing I've ever heard. I appreciate that. I'm flattered, but it'd be a dumb idea.
I don't know. Chris isn't a bad name. It's not bad at all.
Chris Carlin would be great.
I don't know what their last names are,
but Chris and Carlin would be great first and middle name.
I don't think that's going to work. I don't think that's going to work at all. I think there's going to be an angry wife or two if that's the case.
I hope it's not two.
Coach, you know, I heard you talk earlier in the week. They asked about if you have a relationship with Coach Harbaugh. And you said you interviewed with him once at Stanford. I'm curious about your career and the steps that you take as a coach on the way up, and when to know that the right time is to go and pursue another job that might be one to take your step up to get you to that next level. What is that process like in trying to balance it and also, you know, going out and recruiting for the situation that you're currently in?
I mean, everybody takes a different career path to get to where they are. Everyone has different goals and dreams and aspirations in whatever profession you're in. Some in football just want to be a position coach. Some want to be a coordinator. Some want to be a head coach. And everybody takes different paths to get there. Mine is a little bit different than a lot of. I wasn't a Division I football player. You know, I didn't go to a big school. I went to a small school and started my coaching career there. But along the way, I had to make a lot of decisions on whether to take jobs or not take jobs. And a lot of it's on your gut. But I look at three things, you know, really. You know, is professionally, will it help you advance and grow and be a better coach, a better person? Is it good for your family? Because if it's not good for your family, it's not a good move. And then there's the financial part of it, too. You know, so it's professional, your family, and financially, are they good moves to make? And money is not something I've ever looked at. I've always looked at, can I go to a situation, and because of the people that are there in an organization, can I learn, can I grow, can I develop, and can I make myself better by my association with them? And been fortunate along the way. I've worked with a lot of outstanding assistant coaches and head coaches, and I've learned something at every stop along the way. But some of the best decisions you make are the ones that you say no to opportunities, and you look back on them and think, man, I'm glad I didn't go there. But there's a lot that goes into it. It's not just that a lot of people think this is a selfish profession because coaches do what they think is best for them. But you have to look at what's best for the family.
And you, Coach, as we're talking about coaches and your relationship with them, you know, you got to go back to Ohio State. You got to see some of your old coaches. Is there anybody that ever stuck out to you in particular that you just wanted to say thank you to for helping and guiding you?
Well, there's a long list of people that I'd have to say thank you to because I didn't get here alone. I've had a lot of people all the way back to my, you know, junior high coaches and high school coaches and college coaches that coached me, that helped me, taught me a lot, gave me a good experience that really made me want to get into this profession to start. But the people that I've worked with, I could say thank you to an endless number of people along the way. Again, not just head coaches, but assistant coaches and even players that I've learned a lot from that have gone on to be outstanding football players in the NFL. So there's not any one particular individual that I could point out to say thank you to. There's a long list.
They really are the backbone, aren't they? The ones that you really first start to learn the game from, whether it's PAL or high school, those are the guys that kind of fuel your desire, I would imagine, to get into the profession.
I go back to my high school coach. I learned a lot from them. You talked about building a football team and how you go about doing it. I still go back to how my high school coaches did it. I look at the when I was a sophomore in high school, we got a new high school football coach, and we were terrible. Didn't win a game. The next year, you know, we just kept grinding. He kept pushing. He kept building toughness and belief in the football team. And the next year, we came out and had a tremendous year, and he just took off in a great 20-year run. There, but his first year didn't win a game. And how he did that with hard work, with toughness, with discipline, accountability, those are things we still talk about today. And that was, you know, a number of years ago that I learned that lesson in high school.
You know, E, when you think about your high school coaches and your coaches as a kid and the influence that they had on you, how did they fuel your desire as a player?
It actually, you know, started with me. You know, I was, you know, not going to brag, but most of the time I was the best, the biggest, tallest, you know, fastest guy on the team, you know, growing up. But I was never treated that way, you know. When I was in Pop Warner, I remember the last 2 years I played, I had to lose 20 pounds just to play. So running 4 miles a day with garbage bags on your sweatshirts, you know, just to be able to play the game. Remember my coach said, if you don't block, you're not getting the ball at all. And then he did it for one whole game, didn't give me the ball, you know, stuff like that. And then when I got to high school with Coach DeSalle, being getting offered as a freshman from Rutgers was, you know, amazing. But I was the one climbing down into the sewer. It was turning on the water before practice, and then after I had to wait till everyone was done drinking water after practice, and I'm climbing back down in the sewer after working, you know, going through a hard practice, you know, playing offense, defense, special teams. And I was always that guy that always had to work and do it. Nothing, you know, just because I was, you know, the best on the team wasn't mean I was the superstar. I was always at the work. So that kind of, you know, taught me and fueled me that no matter what, I always had to work for whatever I wanted.
Outstanding. Our telephone number, once again, Nissan call-in line is 877-384-1869, 877-384-1869. We have a question from a gentleman here in attendance. Sir, you look familiar. What's your name? Where are you from?
Jim from North Brunswick.
Good to have you again with us, Jim. How are you?
Hello, Coach. Good. Coach, have you ever heard of a team playing three out of the top six teams in the country in their first six games? And if you have, and if not, how do you use that as a motivation? How do you use that for recruiting, and how do you use that as a motivation for your own team?
You know, we don't really talk about it as motivation. We talk about it in terms of it's a great litmus test for where we're at and where we want to get to, and devising a plan to help us improve the way we need to improve to close the gap between where we are right now and where those teams are at. You know, motivation or in recruiting. You know, we do use it in recruiting. If you want to play against some of the best teams and have a chance to compete with, you know, some of the best in the country and some future stars in the NFL, this is a great place to do that. And hopefully with the type of schedule we play and the people that we play, we have some outstanding people that want to join us and be a part of building what we're trying to build.
Thank you, Coach.
Yeah, thank you.
Appreciate it, Jim. We'll take a quick timeout. I want to remind everybody, this week's game is a 7 p.m. start when Rutgers hosts fourth-ranked Michigan for Stripe the Birthplace. In the even-numbered sections, you will wear scarlet. In the odd-numbered sections, you will wear black. And, of course, in the student section, where it has sold out, as we just heard today, everybody will be wearing black there. So it should be a pretty neat environment Saturday night at High Point Solutions Stadium. Also exciting this week, this week's game will be broadcast not only on 1450 WCTC, but also on WFAN 101.9 FM and 660 AM in New York City, and WENJ 97.3 FM, WNJE 920 AM. That will be this coming Saturday night at 7 p.m. We'll take a break in just a couple of minutes. Before we get Coach Shane Burnham up here, Rutgers defensive line coach, I did want to ask you about this project that you have coming. We talked about you being on Fox NFL Sunday this past week, and you had an opportunity to go out west and visit with the guys in studio for Mission Possible, your new television show.
Yes, about 3.5 years ago, I was having an event for Team LeGrand, and I was approached by another guy in a wheelchair who was paralyzed, named Mike Luciano. And he told me about this documentary that he made with some guys with a group called Mission Possible, and that they wanted to get together and show me it. So gave my email and whatnot, and a few weeks later, we linked up, and he brought his crew over there to show me exactly what they were working on. And then they told me that they want me to be the host of this, you know, this show of, you know, people that have disabilities, but they're doing extraordinary things and not letting things hold you back. But you never see a host that's actually going through living life in the face of adversity. And I said, you know, this is perfect. You know, I always wanted to get into something like this, and being able to share different experiences with all these different characters was amazing. And now partnering up with Fox Sports, we've been able to go to different places now with 6 different stories and being able to tell them now. And I got to go on Fox NFL Sunday and be able to share that with the world. And people can now go to foxsports.com/missionpossible to see the episodes there. 4-minute episodes, nice and short, right to the point, and it really touches you at heart. And we got to release our Boston one that we did with the New England Patriots and New Orleans Saints, and it's pretty amazing stuff. And the stories that we got to tell, there's some amazing, amazing people that really will inspire you. So I'm so happy I got to do that.
And I know back you know, in the first couple of years of after when you got injured, you're working through therapy at Kessler up in West Orange, mm-hmm. that there were so many people that didn't have the platform that you have, mm-hmm. and you felt it important to really take advantage of that and maybe share some more of those stories.
Exactly what it's about, you know, me using my platform, you know. And I'm very fortunate to, you know, I did get hurt in front of millions of people, and so they got to see my story and hear about my story. And you know, I'm always about giving back and helping other people out. So as I started healing and getting better, and, you know, my story started taking off more, I started realizing, you know, there's so many other people in this world that don't have this platform or don't have, you know, the support that I have. And, you know, there's no reason why there shouldn't be light shed on their stories. And that's why, you know, I really wanted to do this and found a perfect platform to do it with Mission Possible now. And I'm happy that Fox Sports picked it up. And like I said, we got to do 6 of them, but I'm ready to take it off and really be able to share millions and millions of more coming forward.
Love it. Love it. It's foxsports.com/missionpossible. And, you know, Coach, it's amazing. You have a guy like Eric around who continues to inspire. You know, it's such an incredible symbol for your football team as well, just knowing that he's part of the family. And you get to look up and see that number 52 there forever at High Point Solution Stadium.
Yeah, absolutely. Not only for our team, but just for me personally. You know, every day I wake up. Just thankful to be able to go and do what we do. We have good days. We have bad days. Last Saturday was a bad day, but I look to Eric and his situation, and for him, every day he has a smile on his face, and he wakes up with a mission that's to make a difference in other people's lives. And no matter how we feel after a loss or how good we feel after a victory, you know, I can look to Eric and get inspiration from him and get things back in perspective regardless of the situation. And you know, I've met a lot of people since I've been here, but I've not met one like Eric. And for him to be able to do what he does every day with the attitude that he has every day is tremendous. And again, it's an inspiration to me personally and to our whole football team.
All right, thanks, Coach. Appreciate that.
Absolutely. Everybody out there, and not just Rutgers fans, you've really seen it come across the world. There's so many people whose lives that you have touched. There is no doubt. Foxsports.com/missionpossible. Check it out. All right, we'll take a break. We'll come back. We'll talk with Rutgers defensive line coach Shane Burnham, who is here tonight. And we'll also preview more of the matchup this week with Michigan. It's all coming up next. This is the Chris Ash Show.
Don't just say you're a diehard fan, show it. Nissan's giving you the chance to win a custom-wrapped 2017 Titan, decked out in your school's official colors. To enter, go to diehardfan.com/sweepstakes, and you could turn your garage into the ultimate fan cave. Nissan Titan, take on game day. No purchase necessary, void where prohibited. Starts 9/1/16 at 12/0001 a.m. EDT and ends on 10/23/16 at 11/59/59 p.m. EDT. Open to residents of the USDC. 18 and over. Official rules, visit www.diehardfan.com/sweepstakes. Sponsor Nissan North America, Inc.
Need a place to watch all the pro games? Look no further than Quaker Steak and Lube. Best Wings USA on Route 1 in Edison. 50 TVs, great game day specials starting at just $2. And the best wings in the USA with over 25 different wing sauces. Enjoy our outdoor patio and bar that's open all year round, even in the winter. Give us a call, 732-777-WING. We cater events of any size, dining in or to go. Quaker Steak and Lube, 561 Route 1 in Edison. 732-777-WING.
The Chris Ash Show returns after this local timeout. This is the Rutgers IMG Sports Network.
This commercial is brought to you by Brother International, the makers of fax printers, multifunction printers, scanners, sewing and embroidery machines. Brother is always at your side.
You can make business cards with your name. Print from hiking, hanging frames. Sew some shades, block the sun. Keep out creepy peeping toms.
Oh, no.
With Brother at your side, always good times.
You got a brother at your side. And whatever follows always ends up in good times.
You can make a basket cover for your cat. Another for his brother so they both match. No more mess, make the best. Label all the brothers always undercover and always around. 106 years, better keep on counting.
You've got a brother at your side. And whatever follows always ends up in good times.
With the brother at your side, with the brother at your side.
The Chris Ash Show continues on the Rutgers IMG Sports Network. Now back to Quaker Steak and Lube in Edison to talk Rutgers football. Here's Chris Carlin.
Yes, we return to the Chris Ash Show. Rutgers getting ready for Michigan Stripe, the birthplace, this coming Saturday night at High Point Solutions Stadium. And every week, one of the Rutgers assistant coaches joins us. This week, it's defensive line coach Shane Burnham. Coach, how are you?
I'm good. Thanks for having me.
The outstanding Southern twang. He,
that's right. Can't hide it. Proud of it.
And sounds like a coach, too, because he's a little bit hoarse along the way.
Always. Every day, I swear. I got this permanent rasp in my voice.
Hey, I'm happy, Chris. We're talking some D-line talk now today.
That's right.
That's my nigga, the woods, baby.
And, oh, by the way, I wore 52 all my career.
Oh, yeah?
So, yeah.
Okay.
No doubt.
See, representing.
No doubt.
All right, now, but you were a linebacker when you played in college.
Linebacker, I was.
Now, he was at first, too, so
that's
it's okay.
Right.
It's acceptable.
Right.
Eric is a true freshman. Linebacker, fullback, and then back to D-line. Is that correct? Did I get that right?
Hold on. Linebacker, D-tackle.
D-tackle.
D-end, fullback, D-end, nose guard.
And if I'm not mistaken, that was in the span of about 3 weeks.
Yeah, it was a little bit rough, but hey, I didn't do it for the team.
That's a lot more than I did. I kind of rode the bench all fall. So got a lot more done.
All right, tell us a little bit about your background. You went to South Carolina. Grew up in South Carolina?
No, I grew up in all over the country. My father's a coach, was a coach,
Wally
retired.
Wally Burnham, yep.
Wally, and grew up all around the country following him and his career. But most of my childhood was Tallahassee, Florida. He was at Florida State with Coach Bowden, which was a great experience for me to grow up around that program. And then went to school at South Carolina, played there, and then I got on the coaching train. I started at Richmond, and my very first game as a coach was here. In Piscataway versus Rutgers, actually. So it's kind of come full circle now.
Wow. Coach, what sticks out to you about the D-line and being able to coach down there?
Well, you know, you can coach those guys different. As you know, Eric, it's a different personality, a different mindset playing up front. So it's a lot of fun to go there every day, hands-on with that position. What sticks out about this group here at Rutgers is, you know, I inherited a very mature senior-laden group with Quanzel, JPO, Darius, and then even Sebastian as a junior. So I came into an experienced position group, which for me, obviously, they played a lot of snaps and a great group to work with. They're mature and they know what it takes. But what sticks out to me the most is it's a hands-on, very intense position. a very physical, I think the most demanding position in all of football. So I really enjoy it, actually, a lot more than I thought I would when I initially started coaching D-line.
And with that in mind, it's not that you can really take time off at any position, but it's one of those things where you better be on point on every single play, every single snap.
Yeah, you know, you're not the backside corner away from the ball. You're not a wide receiver who's away from the run. I mean, you're involved in every play. You affect every play. You know, you're pushing on 300, 600 pounds, whatever it is, every snap. So certainly it's very demanding. And the nice thing is you can affect every play. So when you play with that in mind and with that goal, you know, you can be very effective and productive in a game if you got the talent and the desire to do so.
And, Coach, throughout your coaching career, I'm sure your dad, you know, was an inspiration for you. But is there anybody else that sticks out for you, I guess, that led you, you know, to where you are today and being a D-line coach?
You know, obviously growing up around Coach Bowden. But before Coach Bowden, Dad worked for George Allen, you know, former Redskins guy, coach, and legendary coach. So just being around his enthusiasm and the way he approached his work as a young kid and then with Coach Bowden. But in particular, defensive line, Eric, there's a guy named Joe Cullen. Joe is now with the Baltimore Ravens. But when I coached at Richmond, I was coaching linebackers. Mm-hmm. He was our defensive line coach. He left Richmond. He's been with the Buccaneers. He's been with the Jaguars, the Ravens now. He's been with the Lions. So that's the guy as a defensive line coach who I would say has had the most influence on me and how I coach and the approach I take.
Coach, when you were considering coming here to Rutgers, what made it an attractive situation for you?
First and foremost, I worked with Chris at Iowa State back in 2009. You know, when you grow up around the business and you've been coaching all your life, you knew right away, and I don't mean this to butter Coach Ash up, but, you know, I already got the job, so I shouldn't have to, right? But I knew. I just knew, when, you know, this guy is going to be a star in our profession. So when he called, you know, and of course we stayed in touch over the years, but the first and foremost, a chance to get back with Coach Ash and knew the job he'd do here and I knew the type of structure and organization and discipline he'd instill in a program. On top of that, you know, I knew the area. I know that the lifeblood of any program is recruiting. And certainly being here in New Jersey and all the high school talent that surrounds us in the state and the surrounding states, I knew that gave us a chance to be successful when you add that talent to his plan. And I think that certainly all played a part. And for me, the chance to get back out east on the East Coast, you know, like I said, I grew up in Tallahassee and got family on the Eastern Seaboard. So it was a chance to be back close to family and closer to home.
And when it comes to coaching, you know, you look at styles and techniques of different defenses that coaches run. How does it go when you go about taking a job and thinking about what techniques you have to use to coach a certain defense if you run a 4-3 defense, 3-4 defense, you know, all different types of techniques?
Sure, and my background has been I grew up in a 4-3 defense at Florida State, being around that defense, played in that same style of defense at South Carolina when I played linebacker. And I've always coached in that scheme with the exception of 1 or 2 years. I've been in a 4-down front, you know, with some 3-4 sprinkled in, as most schemes will carry a little bit of both. But certainly I like the attacking style that you get to play up front. You know, you're not two-gap and trying to hold guys off linebackers. You know, you get a chance to penetrate. You get a chance to get upfield and play. So I felt real comfort, a real comfort level knowing that I'd be in a scheme I'd coached in the past. And like I said, we actually ran a similar scheme when we were together at Iowa State back in 09. So I knew there'd be a lot of familiarity for me, and I felt good about that, Eric.
Shane Burnham, Rutgers defensive line coach, with us here on the Chris Ash Show this week at Quaker Steak and Lube in Edison. All right, let's talk about a couple of individual players. You mentioned the older guys that have come along. Losing Quanzel for the year, obviously, that's incredibly disappointing. A guy, you know, you've got a few of these guys who came here as linebackers but eventually made that transition for them. Miles Nash is another one that comes to mind. Tell me about those guys in particular, the ones that have to go from a position where they're a little bit further off the ball to really being right down in the heart of it, and what their biggest transition there has got to be.
Yeah, and you see a lot of that in the 4-3 scheme where you take a big linebacker and put his hand down because of the speed and athleticism you hope they bring to the position when they do that. But certainly, you know, Rondell Carter is one of those guys who I don't think played with his hand down much. You mentioned Miles, you know, Darnell Davis, Quanzel. We had quite a few playing outside for us. I think the biggest thing is, you know, understanding the intensity it takes to play with every snap, as we mentioned. It's such a technical position. You know, when you're talking about pad level and hands and footwork and everything happens so fast. You know, you're a foot apart from a 300-pound guy, and in an instant, you know, you're banging heads with them. And so I just think the amount of technique that goes into that with – how to recognize a block, play with leverage, how to disengage. And then when you talk about rushing the passer, there's certainly a lot of technique involved in that. And so that's a huge transition. But what you hope they bring when they do that is the athleticism, the speed, the quickness. And if you can find a big enough guy that can match up with today's tackles and the length you have to play against every Saturday, a lot of times you find success doing that.
And as you're talking about intensity, Coach, and bringing that each day in, you know, you could tell that you're bringing it. Is there any specific player that you rely on to that brings that intensity, that fire every day?
You know, like I said, I got a great group, and Quanzel was, before he got hurt, was steady Eddie. You know, he never said a word, but you knew he was going to be there every day. Mm-hmm. But I guess if you talk about fire and brimstone kind of guys, JPO comes to mind. Mm-hmm. He certainly plays and practices with fanatical effort and just great intensity and leads that group. Darius, who we have to manage his reps, just trying to make sure that we keep the old man healthy for Saturdays.
And grandpa.
The grandpa of the group. But, he also plays with a great motor and great intensity. So those two guys come to mind. And I think it requires that. You know, we talk about you've got to change, Eric, when you come across those white lines. You know, we want you to be a gentleman off the field. But you got to flip a switch and turn into a different cat when you come out there and put your hand down. So those two guys come to mind.
You know, Darius – it's something that was always talked about when he was playing at a smaller size, was just how much he understood leverage and used it to his advantage, because people look at the lines and they think just physically size, what's that going to be up to? So how does he use that to his advantage now that he's playing at a bigger weight, up around 285, 290?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's certainly, if you asked him, it's helped him. You know, he's got more lead in his pencil, which at some point, you know, it's big people beat up little people inside. And so, you know, leverage, of course, he plays with great leverage, which allowed him to have success as a lighter guy in years past. He's really good with his hands. He's one of the best guys I've been around. His ability to get inside hands and get them from the ground to the man right now and race those hands inside. But I think he would tell you, he just feels like he's got more anchor than he had in the past. He's got a little more knockback than maybe he did at 260 or 255. I know he played extremely light early in his career, and I think he just feels more durable now. I don't know if some of the problems he's had with his knees might be a result of playing at a lighter weight. I don't know that, but certainly he's just got more to him now, and he still plays with that technique and leverage that allows him to be successful.
And what do you tell those guys that are a little bit underweight, and how do you coach those guys up when they have to take on those double teams week in and week out, and just trying to be durable and be reliable and be able to have to rely on their technique more than ever, since they are a little bit smaller?
There's no doubt. And, we talk about, it's a fist fight in a phone booth up front. But, I talk about getting your eyes on your hands. We talk about up and down leverage, and you got, side-to-side gap leverage. But I talk about up and down leverage, and I really talk about getting, flat back, whatever you've been coaching in the past. But eyes on your hands. So if my eyes are on my hands and my hands are in the right spot, I've got good up and down leverage. We spend a lot of time talking about that. We talk about climbing blocks and running our knees on contact. I think if you're going to be smaller, you can't afford to sit down and bar stool, as some guys teach. You got to do a great job climbing the blocks and being violent as you run your knees. I spent a lot of time, if you come out there, Eric, I got a new sled. I bought two new sleds when I got here. Coach Ash was nice enough to get those for me. And the guys don't like them very much. They're heavy sleds. We call them ram backs. And we spend a lot of time on there just, knocking things back, being the aggressor, and just fighting and fighting and fighting for that space we're trying to occupy, and then ultimately get off that block and go finish and get off the pad.
Now, if I'm not mistaken, at least during training camp, and I haven't been to practice here much lately just schedule-wise, but Mr. Burnham Sr., while he has been around a little bit.
You know what? So Dad retired and was going to be up here a lot. I thought he was going to actually take up residence in our guest bedroom for a while. I know Mom would have liked that with her grandbabies. But he actually, right before the season, he took a job at Arkansas. So he stayed retired for all of about 4 months. And he just celebrated his 75th birthday. And he's a defensive analyst. So he basically stays a week ahead of the opponent at Arkansas and gives Coach Bielema and those guys a scouting report on Sundays as they turn the calendar to a new opponent. So I couldn't keep him retired very long. But I'll tell you what, if he wasn't doing that, he'd be here a lot. He's one of those guys, he'd like to, I think, coach until, he's got to be in a wheelchair. I don't know. He's one of those guys. He's a lifer.
That's awesome. Working down there with Coach Smith down in Arkansas. He's one of my special teams coach when
That's right.
When I was here. I'm wanted to actually talk about what's life for you here now in the Northeast in Jersey.
You know what? I was, like most Southerners, I was probably a little bit ignorant when it came to the Garden State. I had flown into Newark a few times, and that was really my experience with the state of New Jersey besides the game we played back in 98 versus Rutgers. So it's been a pleasant surprise. My wife and kids, it's been a great adjustment. We had a new baby born last November. So we moved here with a new baby. We live right off River Road, so I'm about a mile from the complex, which is fantastic. The girls are always by. But we've really found this to be a great place. It's so much different than Ames, Eric. You know, Ames is very small and a great place in its own right, but there's not a whole lot to Ames. You know, there's about five restaurants and about four streets. So, you know, just the diversity, the access here, and then the Rutgers community has been fantastic, and we've enjoyed the heck out of it. And it's I wasn't sure what I'd get when I got here, you know, but I get a lot of, hey, where are you from, when I open my mouth. But other than that, I really enjoyed the heck out of it.
These two young ladies over here, do they belong to you?
That's Lindsay and Brady, and they came out with a little daddy date tonight.
You know it. Well, we'll let you get back to your date. We appreciate you coming by and hanging out with us tonight, and best of luck this week.
Oh, thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
Thanks,
Rutgers
Coach.
Defensive line coach Shane Burnham with us on the Chris Ash Show. We'll get the coach back in here. We'll talk a little bit more about Michigan this coming Saturday night when we come back. You're listening to the Chris Ash Show.
Need a place to watch all the pro games? Look no further than Quaker Steak and Lube, Best Wings USA on Route 1 in Edison. 50 TVs, great game day specials starting at just $2, and the best wings in the USA with over 25 different wing sauces. Enjoy our outdoor patio and bar that's open all year round, even in the winter. Give us a call, 732-777-WING. We cater events of any size, dining in or to go. Quaker Steak and Lube, 561 Route 1 in Edison, 732-777-WING.
When you're looking for tickets to that sold-out event, there's only one place to go. TickCity.com, the official secondary ticket partner of Rutgers Athletics. Scarlet Knight fans can save 10% on all orders when you use the discount code Rutgers at checkout. From sporting events to the hottest concerts, Broadway, and family shows across the country, all your ticket needs are covered at your fan-friendly ticket source. TickCity.com. That's TickCity.com.
The Chris Ash Show returns after this local timeout. This is the Rutgers IMG Sports Network.
Train smart, play hard. The Scarlet Knights know what it takes to win on the field and off, so they work harder with the help of the high-quality protein of Dual Fuel. Developed in partnership with Rutgers strength and conditioning coaches, Dual Fuel performance bars and shakes provide elite athletes with the fuel they need to power through the toughest workouts. Give your body what it needs to take on the competition with Dual Fuel. Dual Fuel Bars and Shakes, an official nutrition partner of Rutgers Athletics. Available at campus retailers or at rutgers.dualfuelnutrition.com.
Let's say you're a couple.
Honey, we're a couple.
The kind of couple who needs AT&T's new plans with no overage charges so you can post and share without risking extra data charges?
Yep. That's us.
Then you need AT&T's new plans with no overage charges. Perfect for the no overages, no worries kind of couples. AT&T, mobilizing your world.
On AT&T Mobile Share Advantage plans, after you use all your high-speed data, amounts, data speeds are reduced to 128 kilobytes per second. Posting, streaming, and other data use may not work. Restrictions apply. See store for details.
Rutgers is committed to building championship contenders in the Big Ten, and this commitment means the university must build premier training facilities for elite student athletes from New Jersey, the nation, and around the globe. To achieve this, Rutgers Athletics is embarking on the Our Big Ten Build campaign to raise $100 million for new and upgraded athletic facilities. Be all in and join our campaign today by visiting RutgersBigTenBuild.com. That's RutgersBigTenBuild.com. We're back on the Chris Ash Show as Rutgers prepares for the Michigan Wolverines this coming Saturday night. 2 years ago, it was Rutgers' first Big Ten win over the Wolverines on a blocked kick by Kamoko Ture in that game to help preserve the victory for the Scarlet Knights. And be similar this week with the stripe, the birthplace. It should be interesting, and I know the marketing team and everybody around the athletic department has done a terrific job to really get everybody involved and be a big part of this Saturday night. Looking forward to a terrific environment.
Yeah, it should be fun. Really excited just to have a night game. We've kind of gotten spoiled with the noon kickoffs, but we're excited to have a night game. And to do it the way we're going to do it, it's going to be a special environment, special uniforms, striping the crowd, and night home games. It's going to be fun.
And what's it like, Coach, being able to play on like ESPN2 so the whole world can see you, what your product is, what your team?
No, as long as you play well, it's great. anytime you get a chance to be on TV and hopefully go out and put on a good show and have a good product out there, it's great for recruiting, it's great for our players, and great for our fans.
Okay, so as you prepare for Michigan, what jumps out at about them on both sides of the ball?
Physical up front on both sides of the ball, offensive line. Played this team when I was at Ohio State 2 years ago, and I look at where they're at now. When you look at the improvement of their football team, you start up front. The offensive line is big, strong, and physical. The defensive line is explosive and physical and get after the quarterback. And they're a line of scrimmage football team, much like what we want to try to become. And they're impressive up front.
And, of course, we got to mention probably their best player on the team, Jabril Peppers. What stands out to you about him?
All-around player. He's very talented. He's athletic. You compare him to some of the other very special and talented defensive backs that have played the game. The thing that separates him is his toughness. He's very tough. He's nasty. Plays with an attitude, and that's what you like about a player like him. Is it's not just about out covering people and looking pretty in the secondary. He wants to get mixed up in the run game, and he's a physical tackler.
And a guy that you have to keep an eye on, that occasionally he may show up on the field on offense and either be out there to be a decoy or certainly make you at least pay attention to where he is, be a big threat, no doubt.
Yeah, absolutely. He's all over the field. I mean, he can be at quarterback, running back, wide receiver. You know, he's all over the field, kick returner, punt returner, different spots on defense. So you got to know where he's at offensively. You got to know where he's at defensively, and obviously in the special games too, or special teams also.
I was going to say special teams, Coach. How big of a role is that going to play in field position this game?
It's like every game. It's huge, but it's even more of a concern when you have a dynamic returner like him. It's no different than when Janarian Grant's back there for us. The battle of field position when you've got a returner and you can flip the field those type of players can. It's a big deal.
Well, in playing at night, it's a little bit different. Like you said, you've had all these early starts so far. So during the course of the day, you're kind of sitting around and waiting a little bit. So how do you handle that schedule-wise with the team?
We'll get them up, and we'll do a normal walk around. We got a little path that we walk around the hotel. We'll do offensive and defensive walkthroughs, pretty lengthy walkthrough, just to get them moving, get their minds on the game of football. And then we'll give them a break, let them go back, take a nap, relax, watch a little football in their room. Then we'll get them back up and do some more walkthroughs and meetings with them before we get into our normal pregame routine.
And night games for you. Are you a guy that takes naps, or are you always doing something all day long?
I wish I could take a nap, but no naps for me on game day.
Well, the other thing, too, is when you've got this team at this juncture, you're about to hit the midway point in the season in terms of the games. As you consistently evaluate, scores aside, you have pointed to different guys and talked about their improvement. So as a group, have they improved at a level that I don't want to say you're satisfied with, because coaches never are. Is it a level that maybe you expected and that you're seeing the progress?
You're trying to ask about particular groups that have...
No. The group, meaning the team as a whole.
Yeah, I mean, we've made progress. It's hard to judge at times progress when you look at scores like against Washington and Ohio State, who are both of them are top five football teams. So, a lot of improvement from fans is measured by scores and wins and, that's important, absolutely, but we look at just the foundation that we've been able to lay, the way we train, the way we practice, the attitude and the effort that we come with every day, the way we approach the weekly preparation. Those are all parts of the foundation to build a successful program, and those are all in place. On the field, I think we've made huge strides on defense. And, again, you might laugh at me when you look at the score from last week, but I think we have made huge strides on defense. We're getting better, especially in the secondary. You talked about the corners already. Our offensive line is making strides, and, I see a lot in the special teams also.
Well, Coach, listen, best of luck this week, and we will see you Saturday night. Want everybody out there to stripe the birthplace and to get into their seats early for this game for kickoff.
Absolutely. Come out early. Help create a phenomenal environment and juice up the players as well.
Good luck, Coach.
Thank you.
That will do it for this week's edition of the Chris Ash Show. We want to thank Colin Osborne, as well as Tim DeMartin, Jordan Ozer, and Haseem Phillips from the Rutgers Sports Information Department, and Paul Schrager as well. We'll see you Saturday night, Rutgers in Michigan at High Point Solutions Stadium.
You've been listening to The Chris Ash Show on the Rutgers IMG Sports Network. The Chris Ash Show has been brought to you by us throughout the season from Quaker Steak and Lube on US 1 in Edison to hear from the head football coach of the Scarlet Knights. The Chris Ash Show is an exclusive presentation of IMG, America's home for college sports.